I'll go through this because much more of this will be seen in the actual demonstration. So we create the overall structure, we create what are known as the core sendouts. These are essentially either technical document or techno legal documents, what to do, what not to do, do's and don'ts. Then just the way we do some announcements, we have to provide weekly updates. This is something like a notice board. And then create a calendar, and email facility is available, but to be used rather sparingly, because there is no way the participants can email you directly. So the email should be essentially one way, and we have used the email, I think just now. First email was a week before the course started. Second email was when I passed on to Professor Atre after 4 weeks of instruction. The third email was when Professor Atre completed, we finished half of thermodynamics. So that email was saying, now we are halfway through, now we are moving to the second law of thermodynamics. Thank you.
I have a question related to email. So now that sort of 20,000 students are registered for thermodynamics, have you experienced that somehow people figure out your email address through your website and directly write to you? Have you ever started getting mails of that kind actually?
Just one email like that.
Okay.
Just one.
Okay.
But so otherwise they know UN Gaitonde, IIT Bombay, they can go to IIT Bombay website and somehow send an
email. But they are not writing to you on your other email.
They are not writing to me at all. So but the forum is reasonably active.
Okay.
So they can find either my Gmail address or my IIT Bombay address. IIT Bombay address should be very easy to find.
Professor Fatak, do you get emails on your own thing?
Professor Supratik and I are teaching this course. We have 58,000 students, but we have not received a single email directly from anyone. I think we are reasonably buffered that way. Of course, if someone wants to find out, our credentials, as he says, are on the net. We are professors at IIT Bombay, and our contact information is public knowledge from the IIT Bombay website. But I think, uncannily, although the number of participants are very large, once they are advised right at the beginning that the method of using discussion forum, method of using interaction, etc., etc., I have not found any single exception so far. They abide by, except that they are tempted to discuss quiz problems indirectly, howsoever harshly you advise them, that don't give indication to answers or something. But as he said, I gave this and it was wrong. He thinks it is all right because he is describing a wrong answer. But
okay, now we come to creation. I'll quickly go through because the creation will be seen in another 5 minutes. Now, as has already been said, that typically although a lecture is for about 55-60 minutes, a typical one, here the video I call video snippet is between 5 and 12 minutes. YouTube upload for us is limited to 15 minutes. One of my videos after editing was 15:02. It was thrown back by YouTube. But then I'm a slow speaker, there are enough gaps, so they could easily delete a few seconds and reduced it to 14:58 for uploading. Then I go to the e-studio, record the snippets. After that, what happens, I don't really know. A few days later, in a website, local website, that raw video is available. I download usually and see it either at home or in the office. And then there is a loop here, that if there are any corrections, it goes back to the studio for correction. Meanwhile, parallelly, I do this weekly structure and preparation of quizzes. I will show that structure to you in a moment. Then I pass the structure and snippets to the MOOC lab. The two representatives are there, Vrinda and Urmila. And somehow transcripts get prepared, they come to me in my email box. And I quickly go through the transcript. The only thing I do in transcripts is just reformatting. Maybe I could use a program for it, but I find that some transcripts are CRLF lines, some transcripts are just end of line, the Unix type of formatting. Some transcripts are maybe 72 columns in width, simple text file. Some transcripts are, the whole file is one long line. So all I convert DOS to Unix in single format and put everything with a width of 60 characters. and I tell the TAs who go through the transcript. By the way, now I notice there is Akshit Markan. He is the TA boss and he is the person I talk to. And another student of Professor Atre, Sana Sayed, she is the other one for Professor Atre's things. He will be for mine and Atre and Bhandarkar. And if I have to talk to anyone else, I have to talk through him. So any email goes to him, any email comes from him. So here also transcripts prepared, and then we edit the transcripts as required, modify them, and then I pass the transcripts to MOOC lab. Once the videos are okay, they are also passed on to MOOC's lab, and then I don't know, suddenly I find that once I give them the structure, the whole structure is there on EDX for me to see within a few hours. And once that is done, that is the what I call here upload of the material, and then I get an email, I mean a copy of an email from the MOOC's lab saying let beta testing begin, and let it begins. And then a feedback comes saying, oh, something here is not audible, that transcript is not correct. So we correct them as needed. But the comfortable thing for me is there are just two email addresses, estudio at something something and me209x at something something. Once I send it to these, I don't have to worry, it gets done. That's how it should be. I worry only about thermodynamics, whether the quizzes are right, whether the assignments are proper and things like that. Now when it comes to operation, the main thing is to keep track of each and every forum. At the end of every unit, we will see the structure. There is a forum where you can, somebody can say something, others can respond. This is like a news group or a Facebook column or whatever. Everybody is used to that. And some corrections are pointed out. Now corrections, for example, in a text or in a quiz, it's possible to edit. But some corrections in a video, sometimes instead of say this is the volume axis, I say it is a temperature axis. Written volume, but my word is temperature. Now it turns out that although it's possible to get my volume somewhere as a word and put it there, the turnaround time in the e-studio is of the order of 24 hours because the original one is in HD, is in some raw format. The editing doesn't take time, but after that the so-called rendering takes anywhere between 8 to 16 hours because it's the highest definition HD format. Okay. What goes on YouTube are very different formats, and depending on your internet bandwidth, I think YouTube gives the appropriate format. So for that, what we do is we add a notice before that video saying in the following video at this time the instructor said this, the correct version is this, and transcript has been correct. So I had to do it at two or three places so far. In the second edition we will correct that, but naturally some other errors will keep in. Remember that our recordings are teacher's speech, talk, it's a lecture, it's not a performance. So don't aim for 100% perfection. It's not an LP record which is being cut or a disc which is being burnt and sold. It's a lecture which is being recorded. So there will be slips of tongue. If you try to correct one, something else will happen. And we as teachers have, particularly I have this habit that I can't stop thinking. Even when I talk to you, I keep on thinking. Even when I am conscious that I am being recorded, the thinking process doesn't stop. And that is the one which leads to small errors and slips of tongue. Because I try to improvise and change as I speak. And that is the reason for such slips of tongues and errors. So as I have already said, we have to delete some inappropriate comments. There is a riot act already announced. So
I think about the slips that you mentioned, so the feedback that I got from students is that sometimes the slips are good, where yes, it brings naturalness about the
yes,
yes. You know, otherwise I could have got onto some professional production agency and done a voiceover and got the best format around, but that doesn't give the feeling of a live lecture. So actually slips, I mean if you go to Khan Academy, the guy actually writes and then he writes wrong things and he sort of, you know, I mean, he could have again done master production and made sure that all that wiping out is removed for the sake of efficiency. But you want to create that atmosphere. I don't want it to be the most efficient production anyway. I want it to be naturally sounding anyway. So it's okay to make clips, I think.
No, I think I have already told you about this. Provide feedback wherever appropriate through the forum. Although there are individual fora at the end of every unit, one good thing I'll show you, there is a common forum available, which is everything is transferred at one place. So a teacher need not go to the individual units and see what is happening. A single sheet is available. We have created an entrance survey just after 1 week, just to get the background and expectations of the students. I am designing an exit survey, which will be made available in the 11th or 12th week. There is going to be a final examination. We have announced that all the quizzes together will have 70% of weight. The final examination will have 30% of weight. Now, as was mentioned yesterday, there is no working out type of examination here. Everything is machine evaluatable. And in thermodynamics, there are no essay type of questions. But, you know, you ask a student to solve a problem, he looks at the statement, imagines a system, sketches a system diagram, looks at the process details, sketches the process as expected, the process diagram, makes some assumptions, writes it out, maybe a page or two of working out. There is no way this can be uploaded and evaluated. So everything has to be multiple choice, match figures, true or false. So it's a diluted type of final examination. But anyway, we are doing it. That's why half an hour ago I said that don't give any, don't attach any significant meaning to the grade which is made available online for a MOOC course.
What you talk about is for the EDX.
EDX type.
Yes, I am talking about Swayam.
Swayam things so will be mandated.
The whole idea of the Swayam, as I said, is if you need to go to a level where the grades would be recognized. So there are two types of things that we are giving. One is the audit certification. The audit certification does not require them to give any assessment. But there is an honor code certification which is given by your university. And that honor code certification is actually a certification of some kind of competency, not just attendance certificate. And that certification of competency should generally involve some assessment.
So when we design these first cut courses, an exam should be an integral part.
In fact, I would think that although he accidentally decided like 70% in semester, 30% end semester, and I have also followed it, and we find that to be quite conducive. A weekly quiz or something like that at the end, best so many out of these, and a comprehensive 30 mark single quiz at the end. Is not very difficult to design. If you have to design 100 quizzes also you can design. The questions will have to be designed. And that gives a fairly reasonable reflection of how the students are actually understanding various parts. We may suggest that you may consider institutionalizing a mid-semester exam. So you may have an end-sem exam and a mid-sem exam. Basically, a mid-sem or end-sem exam is nothing but quiz questions which cover all the syllabus points which have been covered till that point in time. Because otherwise, on a weekly basis, you will only examine the student on whether he or she has learnt for that week. So that is the idea. But I would think that for the Swayam initiative, some online quizzes should be there. Also, although he did not mention it is useful to give a whole lot of practice quizzes which are not graded. But where the advantage of online forum is students get immediate feedback. If they make a mistake, they see that answer is wrong, otherwise the answer is correct. And there is an explanation that is provided why this answer is correct. So there is a lot of learning when students do these practice problems. So it will be a useful idea to design some practice problems and include them.
So now I will come to the actual EDX site. I have just logged in. So here you will see what is known as the dashboard. So here, if I log out, I'll have to log in again. So this is the first window. There are a number of courses for which I have registered. Now there is one course, this is ME209X thermodynamics, which is my real course. Now here if you click, you will go to the course information page. Actually, since I have logged in, it brings me to the same page. But if you log out and try to register, you will get, when you click on it, you will get the course announcement page. And if you click on that, you will get the intro video. The intro video is an advertisement. Actually, maybe I can log out and... So here you search for courses. And instead of all schools, we will select IIT Bombay X. And you will find our three current courses. Actually, now this is over. And if you say learn more, watch the course intro video. Now this is from where it really begins. And then there is my pitch. Why isn't my voice coming? There is only one track which is being played, not the other track. But anyway, let us go to the actual course. The intro video is something. And another thing is this. The graphics team made this particular emblem for the course. You have to make something like this. This is somewhere where our graphics, we didn't realize. Now this or something very similar to this, maybe a small part of it, is being used everywhere. You will find whenever a video starts, the initial flash screen will have this. So there is some emblem, some symbol, some graphic which has to be common and should be seen at the beginning of every video or every graphic. So coming back to my course, I will just say view course. And now because I am an instructor, you will see an instructor tab here. And we are in now in the staff view. If I click on staff view, the instructor tab will go. Now this is today's student view. Now let's see how a student sees. He will see to begin with the course information. Two parts, the weekly updates and news. Now here you will see. This was what was released on July 28, a day before July 29 when the course began. Said something about please read this first and then something about this and a link to the EDX demo course. Because if you have not taken any EDX course, you are requested to go through the EDX demo course. So you generally know your way through the website. And then this was for the first week. And then August 4, August 11, August 18, every week you will have some update. So week 7 update, week 8 update will be on September 15, that is next Monday. For some reason we decided, EDX said that your week should typically begin either on a Tuesday or on a Thursday and typically end on a Thursday. So we decided on a Tuesday, but after having worked, it turns out that maybe our week should have started on a Thursday, because Tuesday means we always have to work over the weekend. Okay. So those are minor issues. Now on the right hand side you have course handouts. Now each one is typically a page, a PDF document. I hope it shows properly. Something about this course. A short thing. And the choice of what to put here is yours. Now contents of this course, so this is the sort of syllabus or curriculum, textbooks, reference material, grading policy, something is standard EDX, so we have taken it from there, But here, see, our policy for this course is quizzes 70%, final exam 30%. This is what I said, grade C is 50%, grade B is 65%, and grade A is 80%. And tips for success is another handout. Forum guidelines and collaboration guidelines are here. What to say, what not to say. And finally, after a few weeks, we have provided them steep tests. This is a huge PDF file. We have created this based on NIST steam tables. So some legalese, nomenclature, etc., and then the actual tables. NIST says whatever we have given on our site is open source. And we have provided references to NIST and released it as BYSA. And so far we have had no issues with it. Now the real thing is the courseware. Now I will go to the staff view for the simple reason that I can show you what is available from the staff. By the way, I should tell you, registration for this course and so for CS101.1x is on even now. People do register and deregister at will. So anybody who is interested can just register as a student now and just explore the site, what is what. Now after this, the main place where a student will be working is this courseware. And here you will see week 1, week 2, week 3. These are the sections. Now if you go to a particular week, for example, last time I was in week 7. So it remembers where you were last time. So week 7 is expanded. Now week 8 is seen, although it is not released, week 8 is seen because I am the instructor. Now the moment I say student view, that instructor tab will go from here and week 8 has gone. Actually that instructor's tab should also vanish, right? So if I refresh it, maybe it should vanish. And sometimes it stays. No, it still stays. Anyway, but notice that the week 8, which is not yet released, is not seen. And also what will not be seen is whenever you go to a particular thing, a particular lecture, this is the subsection. Here you will have some, you know, editing and debugging buttons, which will not be seen. For example, if I go to staff view, you will see view unit in studio. Now studio is a replica of this where you have all editing facilities available. So let's explore now week 1. In this week 1 section, when you click, you will see the three subsections which in this course we have called lectures. Now if you go to a lecture, I am here. Now these are the various units. The first lecture has 1, 2, 3, 4 units. And in each unit, this introduction, textbooks and discussion are three subunits. So if I click on this, here the first unit is introduction, the second unit is textbooks, the third unit is the forum discussion. And if you, discussion is not shown here unless you say show discussion. So first day, starting thermodynamics, excited, first course, some general stuff. You go to the second one, now there is a video called engineering and thermodynamics, and then there is a discussion. The moment you go to the first unit, if you click on this, you are in that. So engineering and thermodynamics. If you start this, you will notice even before starting that there is a play button. The duration is from 0 to 7 minutes 24 seconds. You have a choice of playing it at different speeds. A slow speaker like me, for example, perhaps you may be, once you get used to my way of speaking, 1.25x may be okay. May not be for the first viewing, but for the second or third viewing if necessary, you may try that. Or you want to be very particular and there may be a fast speaker, you may even go down to 0.5x. You can download this, either a video and the transcript or both. Once you download it, you can play back through any player that you feel like at any speed that you feel like. And now notice, I think this, I will go quickly, whatever it said here is highlighted here.
Thermodynamics.
And if you go somewhere else, and the highlight will jump there. Now suppose you want to go back.
Gadgets.
So let us this. Click here and the video will go back. So these are linked to each other.
The scheme is similar.
This is, I think, an excellent facility for the student.
We are now trying to.
Now in this, there is again two units. First is a video called primitives. Second, a discussion forum. Here, the first quiz, problem 1, problem 2 and discussion. Each problem in a quiz is a subunit, and perhaps that is a place where subunits have a very proper place. Now you go to some other week, for example in week 3, you will find that the quiz is only at the end, whereas in week 1, we had a quiz at the end of every lecture. So was it, I think, in week 2. So after learning from our experience from the third week onward, at least I have decided that quizzes will be only at the end. This is a student's progress. Now my progress is horrible because I am a teacher. But if you go to a student's progress, in some quizzes I have scored 100%, some quizzes I have just played around with, some quizzes I have just not attempted. But for a student, this will make a lot of sense. There is a calendar. This is the course calendar, and it's highly, this is not mandatory from EDX or Swayam. Maybe we'll make it mandatory in Swayam. But this is something which is, I think, very good, has been appreciated by the EDX people themselves. So this is every Tuesday we have a release for that particular week. And for example, the deadline for week 1 quizzes is 29th July to 11th October, 12 days later. So even if this quiz is released instead of 29th on 1st August, you will still have 11 days with you. Then we have seen this instructor tab, will come to later. This is the discussion tab. Now this is a place where all discussions are put together. Now somebody says need hint for problem 1 in exercise says set C3. Somebody is asking about a certificate. Somebody is asking about change in thermal energy. So somebody is saying why is the thermal energy different at the same temperature but different pressures for steam. Answer is that steam is not an ideal gas, so you don't expect that to happen. Now we as instructors have a facility to pin a discussion, and that will always appear at the top for everyone, not only for me. So you want somebody to look at a particular discussion in any forum, pin that, it comes to the top. Instructor can do. This is a facility only for the instructor. For example, here I can pin it, I can edit it, I can delete it, but anybody can report it saying I think this is improper. Now you can even search. I'm searching for interpolation. And somebody asks, interpolation, what does it mean? Now this is a problem because this is absolutely open. And people who claim to have born in 1894 have registered for this. People who claim who have born in 2014 have registered for it. So somebody asking me what is interpolation is accepted. But you keep quiet. But somebody else, somebody called Gen X, EDX, has provided a Wikipedia link. Nothing wrong in this, so I have just left it like that. I just wanted to show you what will happen. And those things are there in the course info on the right hand side, collaboration guidelines and forum guidelines. I won't spend time on it, but you can register and see for themselves. These are based on generic guidelines. You go to EDX 101, you will find those guidelines, and because that is freeware, so far as this thing is concerned,
yeah, we could tweak
it. You take that down, edit it to your requirement and use it. Now here you will notice that course information shows that there are 19,584 students registered. 7960 have very clearly said, I just want to play with it, audit. 1150 says that I will abide by the honor code. That's their word. 118 want a verified certificate. Now, what is verified certificate that DPP
will make? So this is something which EDX started. You remember I said EDX is a not-for-profit organization like ours, but the regents of Harvard and MIT want them to become self-sufficient later. So that is why EDX was set up. Now that means that EDX must have a revenue source. In fact, it's exactly like university. Either they should be funded by government or they should be funded by the students who benefit from the university or by both. EDX is not funded by government or anything. So they have to have their own revenue source. So far, to popularize the MOOCs, no company has been charging money to people. Now, once the courses are popularized, people have to start charging. But people will pay money only if they find something of immediate value for that money. So one of the things that they came up with, the verified certificate notion, which is closest to the supervised exam kind of notion that I was mentioning. So what they do is they ask you for your photograph and ID, typically a passport or whatever. They record it. Then they require you that every time you interact with the EDX course, you will interact only online and you will interact with a machine which has a webcam. So their software randomly captures your photograph from that webcam and it is compared with your face comparison that is available there. So that is the only verification that they are able to do. Basically what they are trying to say is that the exams that you have given online are given by you and they state so in this certificate. But for such a certificate, they charge money which ranges between $25 to $150, $200. We have grudgingly agreed for $25 to be this. They ask every partnering university which what price would you like to give. Now frankly, our worry was like this. If a large number of Indian students who will register for these courses pay the fees, assuming wrongly that this could be of some direct value to them, then it is a waste of resources of poor students. So we avoided doing that. However, what we find that both on his course and on my course, the number of students who have registered for verified certificate are minuscule. 100, 200 people only across the world have agreed to pay this $25. Otherwise, people are comfortable using the free course and getting an honor certificate. Let me use this opportunity to...
118 out of nearly 20,000.
Yeah, 20,000. So in our case, there are, I think, 297 out of 58,000. That is a very meaningful part. But let me take this opportunity to mention that you remember I talked yesterday about Professor Lagu joining us as an advisor to set up a not-for-profit company. Although we don't want to expand on it and I will talk about it later. But the idea is that for the first 3 years, the whole project is funded by the government. And every activity that we do has funding support. Therefore, there is no reason for any revenue to come from students. But eventually, such an effort has to become self-sustaining and for which a revenue model will have to be worked out. And that is why this company is being formed, which will be sort of jointly owned by a few educational institutions and guided by the entire consortium of universities on what should be the revenue model itself. So that company will get into individual agreement with every partnering university on how the courses should be offered, which courses should be offered. They will pay, instead of the government, that company will pay the cost of conducting the course, honor him to faculty, honor him to TAs, whatever. Okay. And they will collect the revenue from the students on whatever is decided by. So that we'll talk about it tomorrow.
Yeah, but the numbers can be mind-boggling because India is a big country and even if you charge 100 rupees per course and you imagine 10 lakh students registered, you can do the calculation, it can go into crores basically. So it can be a self-sustaining model because the demographic dividend of India being there are so many young people in this particular category and course like Professor Fatak's course Introduction to Computer, where C programming is taught. I mean, probably 30-40 lakh students may register, and then 100 rupees will, you just do the calculation yourself.
Since we are speaking on that topic, let me steal some more moments from your time. But this topic is important because any money related matter is very, very critical. And therefore, I will spend some time day after tomorrow on discussing these issues. But what I would like to state is that as far as this initiative is concerned, and as far as this group and the subsequent members who will join are concerned, the central government is funding all costs that are required to conduct these courses. So as far as next 3 years are concerned, that is okay. So what will happen subsequently is only thing that will. And there is no revenue to be talked of right now. There is no revenue. And even the revenue that we have suggested for the long-term model is, the IIT Bombay principle says that all content should be freely accessible. So anybody who wants to audit the course, no fees to be paid. Any interaction, that means they want to raise questions on forum or ask queries or something, will cost some money. We have suggested a charge of 100 to 300 rupees per course for students who want to get an honor course certificate and want to interact. But any verified certificate which may result into recognition of the credits, we have suggested an amount between 750 rupees and 1500 rupees as the cost of the fees for such a certification. I will discuss that tomorrow. Right now there is no talk of revenue.
In electronics there is something called signal to noise ratio, and the revenue will be noise in this, so let's stick to signal at this point of time.
Now, the second tab in instructor dashboard is membership. You can yourself enroll people. For example, Akshit Markan was enrolled as a TA. And then the course staff, instructors are the highest level. Me, Atre and Bhandarkar. Course staff is delta below that, but essentially have all the facilities of the instructors. Then beta testers are normal students, but who have been tagged as beta testers, and the difference is week 8 today is not released, but it is available to beta testers. Otherwise they are just like students. Then there are discussion admins, discussion moderators and discussion community TAs. These are various different levels. Admins and moderators. Admins are those who can create moderators and community TAs. Moderators cannot create anything, but they can take part in the discussion and delete and edit something. And discussion community TAs are from among the students. So after 4 weeks or a few weeks of the course, you find that there are some really serious students who take part in the discussion, and you would like them to participate and even moderate the discussion, like delete obnoxious posts. Then you can create discussion community TAs. I have not created anyone so far. You can even unenroll a student if somebody is playing any mischief or for any particular reason. You can add beta testers, remove beta testers. This is membership admin. Now, student admin, you can look at a student's progress page. You can make correction to his evaluation in a given quiz, either student by student or for the whole batch. And you can send an email to a student or a group of students. Course specific grade adjustment can be done. This is for the whole course. You find that some answer obviously is not assigned as the correct value, you can do it and then reassign the whole thing. Then data download. This is the all this information, reports, etc. Analytics. Now see here, this is information. This is an important information. Although I have 19,500 students, only 2,457 were active during this 8 days, 7 or 8 days from August 30 to September 6. So this is about 15% or so. 10-15%. That is generally the statistics.
If you have tracked this number on a weekly basis,
have
you seen large number and that kind of number is sort of going down or something
no,
like that?
The, it's not e to the power minus x. It is not 1 e to the power minus x, but it is something x e to the power minus x. Right in the first week, you start with something like, 25%, and then it has gone down to 15%. On my machine, I have that graph, but unfortunately, this is Windows and that is a doors machine, so they can't talk to each other. And now, this is where I wish we could modify it. This is some quiz and some problem in that quiz. But the link is provided through this n digit some hash code. How do I get this hash code? Oh, I have to go to courseware. Why didn't they provide me quiz 3 problem 6? See, for example, in this introductory, I go to introductory, then I go to this quiz, and this staff debug info. Suppose I want this this particular question, then I look at staff debug info and this is the code I have. So I must copy it, I must paste it there, and then I will get the statistics. For example, let me see, if I copy this and come out of this and go to instructor and then go to analytics and then now I know that 6,755 students attempted that, out of which some 1,200 got it wrong because they scored 0 and some 1,500 got it right. Now if 6,755 scored, why doesn't this sum come up to 6,755? I don't know. Now this is the statistics, year of birth, starting from 2014. Fortunately, I have found nobody has claimed this year of birth to be 2015 or 16. Maybe there is a drop down menu which prevents you from doing that. But 1894, definitely there is one. But this is as collected by this gender distribution, 1763, no data. Males 15,000, ladies about 2600, other 43. Now, level of education, this seems to be reasonable. I find when I downloaded the statistics and plotted my own graph, 1993, 94 and 95 are the most popular years of birth. The mean age was something like 20 years or 21 years. So most of them are in the second or third year of engineering. But there are oldie goldies, 50, 60 year old, who helped me out as conscious keeper, small errors, historical mistakes, and very nice comments.
In fact, I started with Fortran programming, or like me and him, and they really turn out to be conscious keeper. They are the first ones to report any error in any quiz or anything. They are also moderators when people crib about something, they respond, please read this, please read that, or something like that. And it is so useful. In fact, they are like colleague teachers. And I will tell you, this is what I checked with Anant yesterday. This is exactly the same experience that every teacher has every day. So you uncannily get some teachers, plus some very, very enthusiastic people on the forum who constantly give explanations, additional hints, additional material, etc. for learning. It's altogether a different experience which cannot and does not happen in a classroom at all.
I've been reading something on neuroscience, and what they say is old people who are worried about dementia or Parkinson's are told that you should take some courses to keep yourself active. So some of these registrations are people who are worried about dementia and Parkinson's.
The last tab here is the email tab. You can send an email to yourself. It just for checking staff and instructors and to all. And here you will find, I said I have sent only 3 emails. So you will notice here, this is successfully sent to 1 our test emails, but this was the first email to all 15,000 then. This was sent on 23. Then second one was on August 25. The third one was on September 8. I think the first one was July 23. So July 23, a week before the course began. Then August 25, when it shifted from me to Atre, and then this is halfway through. I think somewhere if you click, I could get sent email history. Yeah. For example, this was a test, but then this was the first mail. You are receiving this email message because you are enrolled for this. This was on July 23. Welcome message. And if this is not your first EDX course, then you may skip the rest of this message. If on the other hand, this happens to be the first EDX course, please register for this. It's a short course and all that. Then here you see, next one was, let's see the latest one, halfway through. Says we are halfway through our course, we are about to begin an exploration of the second law of thermodynamics and all that. The EDX recommendation is never more than one email per week. We are less than that. We are into our seventh week and we have sent only three. Now, I will show you something which the instructor has to do. For this, no package is available, so I created a spreadsheet. I have been checking this. This is what I call the courseware main file. It's a spreadsheet and this is the structure. Can I make it slightly bigger? Maybe what I will do is I will extract a week out of this, print it out and recommend that it be distributed to you, just to get how the structure works. And you will notice that the structure has evolved. You will find initially it was all one way and now I have settled more or less on this structure. So you will find week 6, week 7, week 8. Now here you will see this is week 7. So this is the section name. So this is all for week 7. There are subsections 7.1, 7.2, 7.3. Name of this week is, there is no name, it's simply week 7. The subsection names are lecture 20, introduction to the second law, lecture 21, the heat engine, lecture 22, temperature levels and performance parameters, lecture 23, reversible processes, and quiz would have been released just half an hour ago. Automatically, right? We don't have to do any action except that set it up for release before the release date and time. And then here you will find that in this lecture, that is the subsection 7.1, there are 1, 2, 3, 4 units. Now 7.1.1 is simply called introduction, then the second law, then some historical comments, then the Kelvin-Planck statement. Now in introduction there is only one unit which is a document. So they will see a printed page or a PDF file. In this section, there is a video and a forum. Again, in this section, this unit, video and forum. But you come to lecture 21, in the very first unit, there are two videos and a forum. So there are three subunits. Forum is a discussion forum, where you can ask questions. Or what I showed you here, this is a forum. Okay, I'll show you. No. It's a, although it looks like a course forum, now come to this courseware and you come to say, let's go to the week 7, temperature levels and performance parameters. Now here I have temperature levels in this, temperature levels 1, temperature levels 2, and a hierarchy of temperatures as 3 videos. So there will be 1, 2, 3. And below that there is a discussion forum, show discussion. So these are the, somebody asked a question. Now this gets replicated, temperature levels 2, this will be replicated here. So I don't have to go to the individual ones, I just keep track of this discussion and I know. For example, here I'll.
So what happens, suppose I am a student and I have some doubts related to this discussion, this particular topic, then I don't have to search in the larger discussion forum. I can actually,
for example, this software thermodynamic properties, here there is no link, so you have just come here, But if you come to this quiz 19B, the post is about week 6 quiz 19B. So you click on here and I can go there. What does it pertain to? So this pertains to this quiz.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
In your spreadsheet, I saw the partial time sums for your videos, weekly time sums.
Yes.
They are quite variable.
Yes, they are very variable.
But there's no guideline on
no
how
guideline.
This.
No guideline. Actually, week here itself is a week here is not perhaps
motion.
Exactly a week
okay.
there. So that's why I said don't go by
okay.
the week.
Okay.
These are four levels. If you want, you can. Add. We have started. We have said weeks, lectures, and then units and okay. subunits. You could start lectures, or you could have.
So the time frame is entirely left to the.
Left to you.
Only time frame that is pertinent from the students is that if you are assigned weekly quizzes, for example, then you will say this weekly quiz will be starting at this point, will be due at this time. So people have actually almost a 8-10 days portion, a buffer, where they can cover up something. Not week cannot be 10 days, but the quiz announcement time and the quiz submission time is typically 10 days apart.
Yeah, I have also one question.
Yes.
Suppose you have planned all the lectures 2 months ahead and everything has been framed and you are flashing it after 2 months one by one and all of a sudden you find that some questions or something occurs in your mind or from the student side and you think that this is important, the audience should know, because that happens most of the time in the class. Some questions someone asked and your 15 minute goes to tell those things to clear because you find that this is relevant.
Yes,
so
in
do
that
you
case,
have the provision for this here?
Yes, you have a provision. For example, I will show you. At any stage, you can go to any week and add a section or add a unit. The only thing is in the discussion forum or in the course update or if it is emergency by an email, inform everybody that this has been added. For example, I think week 4 was it? After exercises, we added solution to these exercises. I remember we added the solutions to these exercises after all the quizzes etc. were over and informed it in the immediate following weekly update.
Professor, I have a question. I have two questions. One is based on your experience with the course, for the entire course, how many hours of lecture have you recorded? I see in a week typically you have about 4 videos of 10 to 15 minutes.
No. It's extremely variable. For example, just look at this. Week 5, 2 hours 32 minutes of videos. Okay. Week 6, 3 hours 20 minutes of videos. Now week 7, 1 hour 50 minutes of videos. Now week 8, I have not yet summed up, but you can say this is roughly 25 minutes, another 25 minutes, 50 minutes, 1 hour 50 minutes, another 30 minutes. So 2 hour 30 minutes, another 20 minutes. This is about almost 2 and 3 quarters of an hour.
And another question related to that is, for example, the same course which you teach here in the classroom, are you able to cover all the concepts within the hour that you allocate on the MOOCs platform?
Yes, this is more or less equivalent of that. So, for example, we have 3 contact hours per week and this averages to 3 contact hours per week. But only thing is, what is a week here may not be a week out there. But a typical thermo class of hours is between 38, thermo course of hours is between 38 and 40 hours of contact. Here also it is roughly.
But I see the variation here, right? For us in a week, if we are meeting 2
yes,
times, it's 3 hours.
This
I'll intervene here. When you say 1 hour of contact, do you continuously speak for 1 hour? Never. Please understand that 1 hour of contact has a whole lot of interspersed interaction, which is completely removed from your video recordings. The interaction happens on forum. So the timing will never be exactly one-on-one matching.
So
but the material that you cover will be very similar. Now, even in a classroom contact, a teacher will vary the amount of interaction depending upon the amount of time required to explain that concept. So, in 1 week, he may speak more. In another week, he or she may speak less.
So, in a way, we can build it in the video based on role plays, based on our experience of the questions that we have over the years.
There is a facility that is required where we say that if we may have a long video, we may say at this point the video pauses and you are required to answer a practice question and then continue from this video. Now, the only way we can accommodate that is we have one portion, one video which does everything, then we have an activity and then we have another video. So, you know, even a 5-minute video with some activities in between. But the point is that 3 contact hours in real life never means 3 hours of lecturing. So, it is in that sense it is variable.
So, that flexibility we have, it depends upon the instructor, how do you plan out the…
Oh yeah, you can in fact have very few videos and have a lot of reading material. But that doesn't gel well because the students are actually expecting some explanation from the teacher.
One thing I think I forgot to include in my slides is based on my experience of teaching, these videos are actually more than what I say in class. Because in class, before I say it, some student asks a question and this becomes an answer, a part of the following discussion. Here I know nobody is going to immediately ask me that question. Why should I wait till it is raised in the forum and then if, so I have preempted such discussion by
so
providing
that is what
additional
I was,
material.
That is what I was kind of trying to build in that we can build as a part of the video that role play based on our experience that what questions generally come on this particular topic. So we can have an animation kind of imagining students and let them pop up the questions and we answer that while we are explaining the concept to explain it better.
Actually, when it comes to something which is discussion based, you may record an actual classroom discussion.
We do that.
And provide it as a video with your commentary in between.
Yes.
For example, that classroom discussion may be 20 minutes.
So imagine
yourself.
It's a fictitious classroom discussion.
You happen to record a classroom discussion.
Okay.
Now you want to present it here. You have that recording being played, but you have a pause button. And initially you give some 2 minutes pep talk saying now we are going to look at discussion. You start the discussion, you keep quiet. After 7 minutes 20 seconds you say pause. Now you tell the current audience what happened in that discussion, why you paused and now what is going to happen. So it will be a discussion on that discussion.
We do that routinely in our teachers training program. There is one extra precaution that you have to take.
Yeah.
Technically, any student who participates in the interaction and raises a question, that question is that student's intellectual property. This is a very small but technical issue. So what we do is whenever we have discussion, we have done this with teachers training program. All participating teachers have to give a written undertaking that whatever they have spoken or whatever they have said is released under Creative Commons open source. So that a participating student does not sue you up later for IP violation. We go to that extent of safeguarding and ensuring that IP is clean.
I have another question. The training which is required for the support staff, the TEA staff, would we be getting some help in that regard? How would they be trained? Because we would not possibly have the competency to understand all the technical aspect of it.
See,
so, is there some thought which has gone behind
The best example of a good TL type.
Because we see you have an excellent support staff over here.
When did you join this institute as a student?
2010.
In 2011, July, December, he was a student in my ME 209. I restricted my TS to only those who have done well, that means the top grade in that. He and another Bansal Shah, where the pair started with me. Bansal Shah left after 4 years. And he has helped me with the
teacher training. Is it a part of your curriculum that they are required to do? Because
yes,
we don't have our students helping
student.
Us in this regard.
He's a BTEC cum MTEC student. That's why
and we cannot ask our PGP regular MBA students who are already sleeping for average 4 hours in a day with the kind of load that they have to help us in this project.
That means they still have 4 hours a day.
To sleep, that's it, out of 24
they can
hours.
Get rid of
I will tell you what you should do. Because there are, for example, there are requirements of TAs. Where TAs are not paid by the institute for this project activity. We just circulated a notice amongst all students of the institute saying we require additional TAs for the following. Transcript work, number one, quiz setting, number two, and discussion forum monitoring. And we said we shall pay this much honorarium per month. The work required will be 8 to 10 hours a week, and the work has to be done without jeopardizing your academy. I got 114 actually proper matching people for the different things. You try this out in your university, 8,000 to 10,000 rupees a month is a reasonable incentive for good students. Is a reasonable incentive. If it doesn't work, very sorry, then like old times when we had no TAs, there used to be, when I used to teach CS 101, there would be 10 faculty colleagues who are my course associates. Including my head and my own guru that works in IIT. All 10 of them will have to slog for every tutorial. There's no choice. So you do work with whatever is available, but it is possible to incentivize graduate students, postgraduate students, even if they are self-paying or they are not paid anything, they can be incentivized. And amongst them, please understand that while you may need a team of 6 or 8, you need 1 or 2 people like him. And 1 or 2 people you can always find. If you can't, there's some problem in hiring students at your place.
No, I don't. Anyway.
This system works at least in all IIMs I know they seem to work. Dholakia tells me it works perfectly well in IIM Ahmedabad. In your place also it works. So it should work in any place. But the point is, we have never tried it perhaps.
We do try them for our course. Teaching assistants for tutorials, we invite them.
Yeah.
But we are already, if we need about 16 tutors for a course, we hardly get applications for 12 or 13, and then we have to take them all and lower the criteria for eligibility at times. Because that's the...
But that will always happen. You will not necessarily always get a larger number of people if your institution is small.
Yeah.
But for a university, it should not be a problem.
Can you guess how many classes I will be taking per week in the university system I am just talking? 16 hours per week, okay? And the students, means I am very happy that this guy is here. The quality of students are not as good as the IITs are there. Because most of our good students who are in the BSc or MSc, they go to the higher institution. So we are flooded with the students who are not properly trained. So you are fortunate enough that you are having a TAs like him. We may not have. That is the situation. So again, means as you said that you may get 1 or 2, but you cannot get a team of 15 or 12, which will be of the equivalent like this guy.
There used to be an observation similar to this when I was discussing, for example, with professors of Stanford and MIT. And I used to say, that look, all our best students are working as your graduate assistants and teaching assistants, where we get students who are not trained in the IIT system. And yet our system is able to provide good training using these TAs. Most of our PhD students and MTech students are not our own undergraduates. And yet they do a wonderful job, not all of them. I would submit that what you say, I will like to correct you. They're not bad students. They are students who have not been adequately trained.
Yeah,
but that's okay. If they are bright enough, they will live up to the expectation. Select the best amongst them. You see, the best students are not necessarily those who belong only to the top institution. I have traveled personally, as I said, for 1 year, just identifying people. In 67 small engineering colleges where there is no record of great achievements by anybody, I found 6 to 8 students at every place throughout a day-long discussion, whom I would love to have as my students in IIT. I think it is just that we do not have much faith in them because of this lax filtering through which they come. But put faith in them and you will always find some people. And I agree with you, you may not find 10 or 12 people. Doesn't matter. Run the program with 4 people. But please note that just as this will become a forerunner for many others to join, similarly this would become a forerunner for many other students also to volunteer. First time there will be a problem, definitely. But I refuse to accept that you will not be able to find at least 1 or 2 lead students who may not be good in their preparation then, but when they join with you, after all they are working with you. And you said 16 hours of time that you have to spend, you are quoting university rules as they exist. It, once again, it has been suggested that the people who participated in the MOOCs offering, this work has to be regarded as part of their duty. And you have to do some mapping. Now this is a call each vice chancellor will have to take. But for your information, when these activities started here, we may not have to teach 16 hours a week, but our teaching hours do not reflect our load. And those of us, including him, when we started this, we were not permitted a single relaxation in our normal duties. We still did it. That is how you kickstart a process. Once the process becomes part of your normal life, the institution, the university will recognize that and will allocate some additional work. So for example, last year I was given a semester off to kickstart this national MOOCs program. But in all previous semesters, I was to take my normal load, which is the whatever is the normal teaching load, and do this as an additional interesting thing. See, as I was telling someone, unless the initial participants from your universities have what I describe in IIT as a characteristic, namely, your screw must be half loose somewhere. Unless that is there, there is not enough passion. And unless there is enough passion, you cannot kickstart this successfully. If you are looking for well-framed rules, well-framed procedures, well-framed acknowledgement of the load, all that will come. But that will not, if we wait for that to happen and then start, we'll never start. So while I agree with you that these are the restrictions, we have to find a way out of these restrictions only. An initial set of people, that is what I'm looking forward to all of you, that you will actually initiate that you lagao chabi going back to people saying, arre karke dekhte. This is the only way to happen. But eventually the universities will have to recognize, will have to factor this into the load. If I don't get TAs like this, I should have provision to employ a staff member who might have passed out from my institute last year, and he might be waiting for a job, let us say he has been selected, but not joined the company, is available for 3 months. Pay him full salary for a month, employ him for 3 months, use him as TA. We have done that. So there are multiple innovative ways of finding out assistance. And these numbers are not sacrosanct. When we say 10 or 12, even in your course, when you say I need 16, where does this number 16 come from? Yeah, I'm sure that, we face the same problem. But I am teaching 575 students right now as we speak. The number of TAs that I needed as per the institute norms itself was some number. The number of TAs I got was much less, and yet the course is running well. So you see, we are also able to manage things in whatever resources we get. And at least when we kickstart this activity, that is the modus operandi that we have to keep in mind. Of course, if we get everything that we need, perhaps the efforts will be required less on our part. But otherwise, that is what we... And I think minimal resources for doing a course well, you will always get. In fact, that is the challenge, actually.
Okay, so finally, other part of this is the final structure. But before that, this is my recording log. So for example, this second law, I'm spending 3 weeks on second law. And the number of video snippets grow from 101 to 152. So this is week 7 up to 116, which is already live. Week 8, which is ready, I think we can make it live today if we want. Okay. And here you will see the name of the snippet. This is the serial number. This is just for indexing purpose. The duration SOK means seems okay. Later on you will see that for week 9, edit 1 means the first editing request has gone. The cumulative time, this is the individual time. And then transcript ready, yes or no, transcript okay, yes or no. Yesterday night or today morning I have passed on, this is a slightly older one, so I have reviewed everything up to 152. And I think the request has already gone for creating transcript. After that I don't worry, today is Friday, by Saturday or Sunday there will be an email with an attachment saying these are the transcripts. All I go through is just browse through them, those long lines etc. I do almost automated. Email goes to Akshit Markham saying these are the transcripts, please get them checked. Then a day or two later the transcripts come to me and then I okay them, they go back to them with the structure for that week and then it's uploaded. Yes sir.
You showed the log for your video recordings.
Yes, this is the one.
Right. So now, I mean in your case the times are typically 6 to 12 minutes or something like that. 6 to 12 minutes or something like that. Now there might be people who, you know, don't accept that it should be restricted to 15 minutes or whatever, and might want to go longer. Could we have a provision where either the instructor or the student can add bookmarks? So the instructor says that okay, I mean if you don't want to really continue till the 29th minute, at 11th minute there's a logical bookmark where one concept is covered or in some manner, and there's another bookmark at 27th minute which you could use. So that if a student wants to pause and reflect on something, there's already some kind of a hint for him where to pause.
See, that is all thing is possible. Even in the current, the EDX structure, which is inherited to begin with by Swayam, you go to a video, you go away from it. Anytime you go to that video, it will have paused there. It keeps track of all your videos. You don't have to put a bookmark. Now when you say that an hour of video somebody may want, I think he or she will go away from that idea the moment it starts recording.
I agree with you because I have…
Because after 10 minutes or something you pause either for breath or for a sip of water or for whatever reason, or you may feel like sneezing or you may want to go to the toilet. Let it be. There are subunits available. So you would find that it's very difficult to record for more than 10-15 minutes.
No, I completely agree with that.
But otherwise there are courses in EDX where the videos are as long as an hour and 20 minutes.
And there is no restriction. In fact, the YouTube restriction of 15 minutes can be very easily by sending a request to YouTube saying you would like to record videos of longer than 15 minutes, YouTube will permit that. All NPTEL videos which are there on video are much longer. They are actually regular recording the lectures. But this 15 minute is suggested as a useful bound based on the feedback that we received from global statistics. The global statistics shows the duration of the video versus the duration of the number of people who have watched that video. And that is, whether you like it or not, that clearly shows that the attention span of a viewer, even of a serious course, average, there are occasions when they will say, the average is about 7 to 8 minutes. It tallies perfectly with the media statistics, which shows that a TV show, even an interesting commercial show, the average attention span is about 7.5 minutes. That is exactly when you get a commercial break. Now that is universal. It does not apply to individuals. No statistics applies to individuals. Just as it does not apply to individual viewers, it does not apply to individual speakers. Now if you have a great orator speaking, I mean there could be 2-hour lecture which people will watch without any problem. But that cannot be the general rule. So that is why these are all suggestive things. Please feel free. And I would think that we should advise the concerned teachers about these statistics and this thing, but they should do best as they do, okay, what they think.
In fact, there is an EDX course on computer programming in which absolutely no redesigning, reworking has been done. That teacher's lectures of approximately 1 hour 20 minutes to 1 hour 30 minutes, including all discussions, have simply been made available. So that way I could have simply said that my 2009 lectures in ME 2009 are simply available, they could have been dumped. But I didn't want them that way. Actually, I considered, I was almost under pressure. We signed up with EDX in July or August of 2013, and Professor DBP came and said, what's the earliest you can offer a thermo course? Then I just thought over and said that, look, if you just tell me that it has to be done within 20 days, I have my old recordings, I just have to, you know, it would be then a discussion on a discussion. I would just record something in the beginning and end. Remember the old humlog, Ashok Kumar used to come in the beginning and at the end. So something like that. I would cut them, because in between there are places where somebody has asked a question or I have stopped for drinking water and things like that. There are natural breaks there every 15-20 minutes. So I could have come, introduced something, then that video recording, then said something, maybe inserted some chota thing and gone ahead with it. I could have done it in 3 to 4 weeks to begin with. Of course, not everything. The first week would have been ready within 3 weeks. But we didn't do that because we didn't feel like doing it that
way. I have one question or such. So when you, this is all fine for EDX, but when we go from EDX to Swayam, where the same lectures are also available in Hindi and Tamil, one more process step will come, right? I mean, there will be...
Yes, that has already started.
Okay, so voiceover, so how will, the Hindi will happen in a voiceover?
Yes, currently.
And there will be other experts, I mean, who will
see,
speak?
What is planned is like this. So they take a video of mine. The transcript is converted, the transcript is translated, come transliterated in Hindi, and somebody gives a voiceover. That audio is superposed, and the transcript in Hindi is superposed, I mean replaces transcript in English, and then it is uploaded.
That just increases production time, right? So you have to plan your little more.
Yes, but then my involvement is negligible. As far as I know, the current level of my involvement has been, from my experience, I just, did some filtering on that, my transcripts, and created a list of, I think, 200 words, which I don't want to be translated. Thermodynamics, temperature, energy, those will be transliterated. So thermodynamics will be written, thermo, all that in Devanagari or whatever is the script of that language. Currently it's Hindi, so it is Devanagari. And after that, the first few videos have been shown to me, whether the translated version looks okay or not. I gave some feedback. I said, Ushmagati ki nahi chalega, the thermodynamics hi chahiye. Initially they used the words Ganit and Vidnyan, which I thought, I was under the impression that Ganit is Ganit in all Indian languages, but yesterday somebody told me that in Tamil, Ganit is not Ganit. So I think mathematics will have to remain mathematics.
And also, the point that Dr. Lagu spoke about, the translated video doesn't have to be released at the same time. That will be released later. So you can take time for the translated
that's
video to come.
That's a different course altogether.
Yeah, yeah.
Possibly. That's a management disease.
So just one point, because I think it's relevant, we have people from CEC here. You also had your lecture on NPTEL,
yes,
which was an hour long, roughly 55 minutes or something.
Actually, that was, it was an actual classroom lecture.
Yeah.
2009, July, December, you can go through the MP site. The lecture slots were 1 hour, 25 minutes, and after editing, bold erasure and all those things have been edited out. And typical video is between 1 hour and 10 to 1 hour and 20 minutes.
Yeah, so why I'm talking about this is because
29 videos.
We've had a lot of discussion in our meetings at the ministry. Professor Fatak's been involved also, where there's a set of people who say that there are 6,000 hours of lectures on NPTEL, and these guys have some 5 or 6,000 hours or something else, CC. So why can't we chunk it into 10-minute things? And you know, Professor Fatak and I have been fighting this battle. In fact, we did a lot of pedagogical research also on this, that it is not, you can't just chunk a 1-hour video into 10-minute slots.
No, you can't.
Because it doesn't make any sense to the learner.
No.
So the 10-minute is actually quite relevant from the point of view of attention span and all of those things. And the way that we are setting it up here, with the quizzes and interaction forum, everything in between. So I think maybe you can spend some time just explaining, especially for the benefit of CEC who's actually sitting here. And also one more thing, Professor Fatak, CEC has a particularly funny issue in the sense that they are not a university. So their lectures are actually created by faculty from different universities, some of whom are sitting here themselves. Because for example, Jamia has been cooperating, and I think IGNU, who? EFLU. Yeah, so there are, so their issue is, do they do the work or does the university do the work? So that is something that you would have to actually look at.
No, I don't know the structure of CEC, nor I am aware of the links between CEC and others. But one thing is, I ask any teacher, suppose you are given a topic and a level of discussion of that topic, and you are given 1 hour, you will use it in a particular way. Then you are told that, look, I will give you 1 hour, but 15 minutes today, 15 minutes tomorrow, 15 minutes day after tomorrow, and 15 minutes day after tomorrow. You will spend some time in thinking and redoing it. And I'll ask ourselves a question, you know, why do TV serials are serials? Why 20 minutes a day and 13 episodes day after day or week after week? Why not a movie? Why are serials more popular than movies? The reason is attention span. And I think if a thermo course, for example, has to be converted from the lecture format of 55 minutes to snippet format of approximately 10 plus or minus 3-4 minutes, it better be done by a thermo teacher. He knows best.
Yes, sir, I want to submit a point related to CEC content. We at MCRC are also making courses for BA Mass Communication Program under CEC. The key difference here is CEC content was for two purposes. One was for broadcast medium. It was going on Vyas channel. And the video composition, short composition for that is entirely different what we want on computer screen. Long shots. For example, I saw some MOOC programs. So the faculty member very close up face is shown on the screen, maybe 4-inch or 10-inch screen. For CEC programs, this was entirely different. 40-inch or 50-inch was our device on which we were consuming the content. So to customize that content exactly for MOOC program is very difficult. We'll have to go through the entire content and see which part of that content is suitable for this kind of program. The second part of CEC content is they used it for Sakshat portal.
For what?
Sakshat, they have a Sakshat portal. So the content is basically on a web-based server, more on e-learning or self-learning kind of content is there. But that content also originates from the TV content, where the focus was broadcast medium. That has been customized for e-portal. So to fit those content directly into MOOCs is very, very difficult. What I suggest is a minimal part from that content can be used here. Most of it won't be useful here in MOOCs, because this is screen.
No. The content will remain the same. It is
but
the
presentation
will differ.
Yeah, because it has been shot in an entirely different format.
Correct.
For example, it has a long shot. Yeah, my point is to customize it, just to show it on a small screen may not look that appealing. So no. One is to reduce the duration, another is the composition of this shot may also.
I would like to add two more points to what you are saying, and I would also like to mention another possibility. First of all, there is a very fundamental difference in the approach for content creation for these and NPTEL efforts and what we are trying. Here we are not talking of content, we are talking of course. A course, why weeks, for example? There is no concept of weeks in any such content. This is 40 hours of recorded lectures in the entire thing. And they are to be chosen and viewed by the viewer as per one's own wish list. Whereas here, we want a discipline by every viewer to follow a certain pattern with some activities, with some action, with some quizzes. So there is a, just as there is a difference between a course and content, there is a difference between video recordings prepared primarily as contents, however great and good quality they are, they cannot fit into a course directly. In fact, if the same teacher is teaching that course again, that teacher will vary the contents. And that variation is not possible in fixed contents. Okay, that is one. Second, what prevents us by saying that this is my MOOCs course designed as per the MOOCs methodology as appears to have been accepted elsewhere. But for every week, I will provide additional learning material. Don't we do that? There is no need to restrict our additional material to be only text material. We provide wiki examples, we can provide additional videos. Please listen to these videos, they additionally explain this concept. Even there, you have to judiciously choose a video recording lecture which actually covers that particular topic. And you may have to indicate, watch this video from 1 hour 10 minutes to 1 hour 15 minutes, some such thing. So it is in that context, existing video content could be used. But as independent contents to be actually retrofitted into MOOCs, I would agree with Professor Kasim that would not be a very fair thing to do if you look at very fundamental pedagogical difference that here we are talking about a course and not about recorded contents.
I just wanted to add what we meant when we were saying this. We were not talking about retrofitting anything, but what we were trying to tell you that in India, most of the internet is accessed by other screens than computer screen. It is tablets and handheld devices, mobile devices, which is a different, very small screen. When we are designing and thinking afresh on this idea, this is a very good, nice time to start thinking of a small screen as well, as far as the content is concerned. And because that would be the beginning of something new, and this is very easy to implement if we give that thought anywhere. That was, thank you.
Sir, I was talking to Dr. Barma. CC has two type of content. One is the straight video lectures as we do, what Professor Kasim is saying. That was developed for the television broadcast. Then 2011 onwards, under NMEIC, we started producing e-content. E-content, I find it has almost 80% of the elements as we are discussing in the MOOCs. However, the design format was different. It was for e-learning on the web. So content is ready in 8,500 modules are ready. We have completed 8 subjects, and this December we are going to complete total 29 subjects under phase 1. Problem at CEC that we are not a university, so we don't have the faculty. But the courses has been designed by the lead faculty in the respective host universities. And we are in the discussion process with the host universities. So right now we have compiled some 10 courses with the consent of the lead university, lead faculty in the university. So it can be a sort of thing that the faculty can be trained, so he can take up the courses using the existing content, because the already content is ready. So that is the proposal CEC was putting actually. Thank you, sir.
Sir, for the past 2-3 months, I have been looking after this e-content materials at AJKMCRC. So I'm getting I got a chance to look at all the programs which are made to some extent. And after, when I came to know that we are launching this, and then I'm also looking at what I understood that I agree with Professor Kasing and Professor Patak, because see, even in the present situation, that the courses which we made, the fast, say, BA program, the curriculums, it's a curriculum-based program that we made. And say, the dynamic nature of mass communication, keeping in mind, say, communication models or theories in the context of convergence or social media, I need to redefine. It's very dynamic. It's changing every day. So content which is made, this program is now we are completing in the next month. 3 years are over, phase one is over. Say introduction to communication is made 3 years back. So now how dynamic is the kind of dynamic nature the MOOCs is having. So I need to update. I mean, does this facility only can be, you know, co-opted with the making a new, you know, these clips and other things. So that is why this limitation is there. So there is a rich content we made. So this dynamic nature of updating with the existing communication, framework, it may not be possible. This is my opinion.
Yes, sir, I want to add one more point. After we committed for two courses on MOOCs, we went back and examined what kind of content we have made for CC. So it was being made as per some syllabus prescribed by UGC. Then we found out that syllabus was designed in 2002. So this doesn't match with what we propose to do now and what we have been doing over the years. Lot of customization, changes, modification, additions or deletions would be required. That's what I wanted to add.
Yeah. So let me hasten to add that the courses that you have identified, and by courses, of course, now I hope we understand that we mean subject or paper. We're not talking about a B program or something, which you have identified in a hurry. If after this interaction and after this orientation, if you feel that you can do perhaps a better job with some other subjects or something, please do feel free. We have not made any announcement yet. You have merely indicated something to us, and us means who are we? Actually, let me say, I am a representative of this collective body who speaks with the ministry and tries to implement it. So as your representative, I would never like to do anything which is not completely and clearly acceptable to every component of the body. So please feel free to go back, re-examine the courses that you have committed. It is quite possible that initially you might have thought of something, as you are saying, and this dilemma might be faced by other colleagues as well. Absolutely no problem. In fact, you start examining it right now. In fact, between today, tomorrow and day after, go back to your other colleagues on phone or email and say, we would like this consideration. And on Monday, we would like this decision. The only problem is we have limited time. This limited time, we should not go by a thing that just because you have said this once, it's okay. Although I would not expect that to happen, but suppose 17th you declare something to me. And on 21st, let us say out of these 14 universities and 20 courses are collected, one university says, boss, I made this mistake. Out of these two courses, I need to change this one course. Can you accommodate that? Can we not do that on an emergency? So, but only thing, why we put all these date restrictions, last date, etc., you all know. Because there is a minimal time required to handle all the details properly, ensure that they are correctly reflected on the site, etc. You are already seeing what you are currently looking at, SWAM site. How many gaps are there? That is because we were forced to give you an older version which is still under development. The newer version is going on, and there is a minimal time which it takes to put everything properly. So please feel free to go back, examine things. Ideally, you should complete everything by 17th and submit all the details which are required. We will consider whether 17th can be made into 18th, but there are certain deadlines which we cannot.